The Hague and Versailles Peace Conferences by Sanderson Beck. At the close of the Napoleonic Wars in 1815, the Congress of Vienna established the balance of power they called the Concert of Europe. With some popular support from peace societies, which were founded at that time, and with the concern for international law, national leaders were able to solve many of their differences by means of arbitration. Between 1815 and 1900, of the 200 cases in which states agreed to arbitration, not a single case led to a war. However, the states had not pledged that they would submit to arbitration in every international conflict. The Swiss humanitarian Henri Dunant initiated a movement that led to a conference at Geneva in 1864 that protected the sick and wounded in land warfare with the Red Cross Convention. 4 years later, another Geneva conference added more articles for a convention on the sea, but these articles were not ratified. Also in 1868, Tsar Alexander II invited European diplomats to meet at St. Petersburg to outlaw especially cruel weapons. Another conference, initiated by the Russian Tsar, led to a meeting at Brussels 6 years later in which representatives of 15 European nations formulated laws of land warfare. These were influenced by the general orders for the United States Army that President Lincoln had issued during the Civil War, based on the ideas of the German-born Francis Lieber, who wrote A Code for the Government of Armies. However, British diplomats refused to consider naval issues at this 1874 conference. In 1890, the United States and 10 other American republics signed a Pan-American Treaty of Arbitration, but it was not ratified. The Hague Peace Conferences. In 1899, Tsar Nicholas II, concerned that Russia was at a financial disadvantage in the armaments competition, proposed a conference to discuss limitation of arms, the laws of war, and arbitration to settle international disputes. Peace advocates championed the Second Russian Circular by calling for a peace conference, and the Dutch government offered The Hague as a meeting place. Quaker Dr. Benjamin Trueblood for years had been writing essays in the American Peace Society's journal, The Peace Advocate, on plans by Kant, Ladd, and others for international organization. Quaker Alfred K. Smiley had been inviting peace leaders and prominent politicians to his hotel retreat in New York annually since 1895. The Polish Jew Ivan Bloch attended the 1899 conference and gave the delegates copies of his sixth volume, The Future of War, which showed how war had become so economically ruinous. The first Hague Conference that began on May 18, 1899, included 26 states and is considered the first international assembly that met in peacetime in order to preserve peace instead of to conclude a war. The diplomats' meetings went on for 10 weeks, and their official act agreed on the following conventions and declarations. 1. Convention for the Peaceful Adjustment of International Differences. 2. Convention regarding the laws and customs of war by land. 3. Convention for the adaptation to maritime warfare of the principles of the Geneva Convention of the 22nd August 1864. 4. Three declarations. 1. To prohibit the launching of projectiles and explosives from balloons or by other similar new methods. 2. To prohibit the use of projectiles, the only object of which is the diffusion of asphyxiating or deleterious gases. 3. To prohibit the use of bullets which expand or flatten easily in the human body, such as bullets with a hard envelope, of which the envelope does not entirely cover the core or is pierced with incisions. Although recognizing the regulation of the rules of war for those nations agreeing to them, The Kaiser declared most of the goals utopian because not a single country was willing to submit all questions to arbitration. The permanent accord of arbitration that was established could be used voluntarily to resolve differences. The first convention on the Pacific Settlement of International Disputes provided an instrument for a permanent panel of commissioners. Each party to the dispute would select two commissioners, and the fifth commissioner was to be named by the other four. In September 1900, ministers of the ratifying countries met to establish the Administrative Council of the Permanent Court. They included the eight great powers: Russia, Germany, Austria-Hungary, Italy, France, Great Britain, United States, and Japan, plus Belgium, the Netherlands, Spain, Portugal, Romania, and Siam. A Pan-American conference began in October 1901 and agreed to all three Hague conventions. Delegates from Argentina, Bolivia, Paraguay, Peru, Uruguay, El Salvador, Guatemala, Dominican Republic, and the host Mexico even agreed to a treaty of compulsory arbitration. United States President Theodore Roosevelt submitted a dispute about a pious fund going back to 1697, and on October 14, 1901, the five arbitrators awarded payments to Catholic bishops in California. In 1902, Argentina and Chile agreed to a convention on limitation of naval armaments. Britain and France signed an arbitration treaty in 1903. Roosevelt followed their example and signed arbitration treaties with France, Germany, Portugal, and Switzerland. He was negotiating with Great Britain, Italy, Mexico, Russia, Japan, and others when the Senate, led by Henry Cabot Lodge, insisted on approving each treaty. T.R. felt this undercut his efforts and therefore abandoned them. An attack by Russian warships on British fishing vessels while on their way to fight the Japanese in 1904 was judged a violation in the Dogger Bank case. Russia accepted the decision and paid Britain £65,000. Theodore Roosevelt supported arbitration and arms limitation at the Second Hague Convention in the summer of 1907, when 44 nations attended, including 24 from beyond Europe. A Korean delegation was turned away because they had not been invited. Japan forced the Korean monarch to abdicate and later took over the country. After much debate, the conference had to announce that they could not agree on how to choose judges for the World Court. The French favored an obligatory arbitration treaty, but the Germans opposed this. As in 1899, the 1907 conference failed to limit armaments, and many nations pushed ahead with their naval construction of large battleships despite the efforts of the London Naval Conference, though the Declaration of London in January 1909 did clarify issues of international law. 10 of the 1907 Hague Conference's 11 conventions were ratified and are still in force for those nations. These include such legal issues as the opening of hostilities, laws and customs of war on land, rights and duties of neutral powers, status of enemy merchant ships, conversion of merchant ships into warships, laying of automatic submarine contact mines, bombardment by naval forces, maritime warfare, and restrictions on the right of capture in naval war. At this conference, three neutrals were added to each commission of inquiry. Between 1909 and 1914, the Permanent Court of Arbitration made judgments in 10 cases. This method was used in 1910 to settle a dispute over the Newfoundland fisheries between the United States and Britain. Under President Taft, the United States negotiated arbitration treaties with the British and French, but the Germans declined. In 1912, Taft complained that the Senate had truncated the treaties with its amendments. A third Hague Peace Conference was planned for 1915, but because of the World War, it was not held. Wilson and a League for Peace. Friendship is the only cement that will ever hold the world together. Woodrow Wilson. Interest does not bind men together. Interest separates men. There is only one thing that can bind men together, and that is common devotion to right. Woodrow Wilson. What we seek is the reign of law, based upon the consent of the governed and sustained by the organized opinion of mankind. Woodrow Wilson. Political liberty can exist only when there is peace. Social reform can take place only when there is peace. Woodrow Wilson. Several years after being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, in 1910, Theodore Roosevelt spoke to the Nobel Prize Committee about a League of Peace, which the great powers could form, not only to keep the peace among themselves, but to prevent by force, if necessary, its being broken by others. The problem with the Hague approach, he believed, was that it lacked an effective executive police power. Until that was achieved, he suggested that peace could be assured by a combination of powerful nations which sincerely want peace and have no intention of committing aggression. Roosevelt concluded that the statesman who could bring this about would have the gratitude of all mankind. In 1909, Norman Angell published a pamphlet that was enlarged to a book and went through several editions by 1913 as The Great Illusion. In this work, he endeavored to show that the development of industry and commerce had made the use of military power economically and socially futile because nations no longer gain by trying to take over territories beyond their borders. To tamper with credit and commerce by confiscation is self-injurious to powers that attempt this, as small nations are able to compete with them for trade effectively without having expensive military power. Neither do nations impose their moral ideals on other nations by means of war, because all of the moral and ideological struggles are occurring within nations and across political boundaries, not between nations. Thus, he prophesied that armaments are obsolete and that the current arms race between European powers, such as Germany and England, were self-destructive. He lamented the failure of the Hague conferences to bring about any disarmament and appealed to public opinion to see through the current political illusions. The tragic story of the League of Nations begins with the man who conceived it and offered it to the world, who developed its charter and bore the pains of its formulation at the peace conference in France, and who broke down in exhaustion when his own nation, the United States, refused to ratify it in the Senate. Thomas Woodrow Wilson was born December 28, 1856, in Staunton, Virginia. His father was a Presbyterian minister, and Woodrow was a deeply religious man throughout his life. He was fascinated by politics and longed to be a statesman like England's Prime Minister Gladstone. He wrote several books on government and taught political economy at Princeton University. As an educational reformer, he was unanimously chosen president of Princeton in 1902. Wilson emphasized broad liberal studies more than specialization and mere preparation for a career. In 1910, the Democratic Party nominated him for governor of New Jersey, and his persuasive expression of progressive principles swept him to victory. His liberal reforms were successful, and in 1912 he won the Democratic presidential nomination and then a popular plurality over the divided Republicans and Theodore Roosevelt's Progressive Party. He offered new freedom and set out to break up the privileges of trusts and tariffs. He championed the workers' right to overtime pay beyond an 8-hour day. However, his greatest challenges were to be in foreign policy after the outbreak of the World War in 1914. In the spring of 1914, President Wilson sent his close friend and advisor, Colonel Edward M. House, to Europe as an unofficial ambassador for peace. House met with German officials and the Kaiser, explaining that with the community of interests between England, Germany, and the United States, they could together maintain the peace of the world. However, England was concerned about Germany's growing navy. House went to Paris and then London, where he conferred with Edward Grey about negotiating with Germany. Even after the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand, the event which precipitated the war, House returned to Berlin and appealed to the Kaiser through a letter that England, France, and Germany could settle their differences peacefully. Many years later, the Kaiser admitted that the mediation offered by Wilson and House had almost prevented the war. However, the German militarists were intent on fighting, and the war broke out with Austria leading the way. President Wilson, on August 19th, declared that the United States was neutral, and he requested that the American people be impartial. He tried to mediate peace between the European powers through his pacifist Secretary of State, William Jennings Bryan, and in January 1915, Wilson again sent House to Europe on a peace mission, but both efforts failed. Hamilton Holt and William B. Howland initiated a meeting of American professors at the Century Club in New York on January 25, 1915, to discuss a future league that could guarantee two principles: friendly settlement of disputes between nations and protection of the territorial integrity and sovereignty of nations against outside aggression. On April 9th at Independence Hall in Philadelphia, the League to Enforce Peace was organized, and former President William Howard Taft became its founding president. In England, a League of Nations Society was founded in May 1915, and the idea was supported publicly by Edward Grey and Herbert Asquith. In the United States, numerous branches of the League to Enforce Peace sprang up around the country. On May 27, 1916, the League to Enforce Peace heard speeches by President Wilson and Republican Senator Henry Cabot Lodge. Lodge was wary of forming permanent alliances, about which George Washington had warned America. But this, he felt, should not preclude joining with other civilized nations to diminish war and encourage peace. In fact, Senator Lodge stated strongly that they must find some way in which the united forces of the nations could be put behind the cause of peace and law. In his speech, President Wilson called for a new and more wholesome diplomacy and a way for the nations of the world to band themselves together so that right may prevail against any selfish aggression. Civilization is not yet firmly established until nations are governed by the same code of conduct that we demand of individuals. He outlined three fundamental principles. First, that every people has the right to choose their sovereignty. Second, that small nations as well as large ones ought to have the guarantee of territorial integrity. And third, that the world and the rights of its people and nations ought to be protected from disturbing aggression. He proposed that the United States initiate a movement for peace calling for a universal association of the nations to maintain the inviolate security of the highway of the seas for the common and unhindered use of all the nations of the world, and to prevent any war begun either contrary to treaty covenants or without warning and full submission of the causes to the opinion of the world, a virtual guarantee of territorial integrity and political independence. While speaking to West Point graduates in 1916, Wilson contrasted the spirit of militarism to the citizen spirit, and he asserted that in the United States, the civilian spirit is intended to dominate the military, which is why the president, a civilian authority, is commander-in-chief of all forces. In September, Wilson was renominated by the Democratic Party, and in his acceptance speech, he discussed world peace. America must contribute to a just and settled peace because no longer can any nation remain wholly apart from world turmoil. Again, he appealed to world opinion to establish joint guarantees for peace and justice in a spirit of friendship. President Wilson's re-election was promoted under the slogan, "He kept us out of war," and he managed to win a narrow victory. In January 1917, the Germans decided to pursue unrestricted submarine warfare. Wilson was trying to get the Western Allies and Central Powers to negotiate peace with each other, and he was not informed of the Germans' change in policy when he delivered his Peace Without Victory speech on January 22nd. This was the first time a president had appeared alone before the Senate since George Washington vowed never to return there. Wilson expressed his hope that peace could be negotiated soon, and he was convinced that after the war, an international concert of power must prevent war. He offered the United States government, in its tradition of upholding liberty, to serve in using its authority and power to guarantee peace and justice throughout the world by means of a League for Peace. The president wanted to indicate the conditions upon which the United States could enter into this process. First, the war must be ended and by a treaty of peace that will be universally approved and guaranteed by a universal covenant, which must include the peoples of the New World. The organized force of mankind protecting the peace must be greater than any nation or probable combination of nations. Wilson did not believe that the war should end in a new balance of power, but rather in a just and organized common peace, for no one can guarantee the stability of a balance of power. Neither side really intends to crush the other. Therefore, it must be a peace without victory so that the victor will not impose intolerable sacrifices which result in resentment and probably future hostilities. Equality of nations is the right attitude for a lasting peace, as well as a just settlement regarding territory and national allegiance. Equality of nations means a respect for the rights of small nations based upon the common strength of the concert of nations, not upon individual strength. A deeper principle yet is, governments derive all their just powers from the consent of the governed, and that no right anywhere exists to hand peoples about from sovereignty to sovereignty as if they were property, that henceforth inviolable security of life, of worship, and of industrial and social development should be guaranteed to all peoples. Peace can only be stable with justice and freedom, otherwise the spirit rebels. Wilson asserted the importance of freedom of the seas and also the need to limit navies and armies. He felt that he was speaking for liberals and friends of humanity in every nation, for the silent mass of mankind everywhere. He suggested that the American principles of the Monroe Doctrine should be extended throughout the world so that every person should be left free to determine its own polity, its own way of development, unhindered, unthreatened, unafraid. These principles of self-determination, freedom, and protection from aggression are the principles of humanity and must prevail. Wilson struggled to keep America out of the war, but when the Germans announced submarine warfare even against neutral shipping, he immediately broke diplomatic relations with Germany. American intelligence reports indicated that Germany was trying to form an alliance with Mexico against the United States. Wilson had considered entry into the war a crime against civilization, and he loathed the implications. Privately, he told the reporter Frank Cobb, "It would mean that we would lose our heads along with the rest and stop weighing right and wrong. It would mean that a majority of people in this hemisphere would go war mad, quit thinking, and devote their energies to destruction." However, in March 1917, several U.S. ships were attacked, and the president decided to propose a declaration of war to the Congress on April 2nd. He appealed to international law and the freedom of the seas. Because of the loss of non-combatants' lives, he interpreted the German submarine warfare against commerce as warfare against mankind. He did not recommend revenge or the victorious assertion of physical might as modus for action, but rather the vindication of human right and a refusal to submit to wrongs. Therefore, since the Imperial German government was at war with the United States, they must accept the belligerent status thrust upon them. Wilson clearly stated that the purpose of America's role is to vindicate the principles of peace and justice in the life of the world as against selfish and autocratic power, and to set up amongst the really free and self-governed peoples of the world such a concert of purpose and of action as will henceforth ensure the observance of those principles. He declared that a new age was beginning in which nations and governments must be held to the same standards of conduct and responsibility as the individual citizens of civilized states. He indicated that America had no animosity toward the German people, and he explained that small groups of ambitious men were using those people as pawns under the veil of the private courts of a privileged class. Wilson believed that peace could only be maintained by a partnership of democratic nations. Autocratic governments cannot be trusted. Therefore, Americans must fight for the liberation of the world's people, including the German peoples. The world must be made safe for democracy. Peace must be founded on political liberty. President Wilson disavowed any desire for conquest or dominion. America was to be merely one of the champions of humanity's rights. Wilson's speech was greeted with wildly enthusiastic applause. Later, he thought how strange it was to hear applause for a message that meant death for many young men. The United States was involved in the World War, but it would be 6 months before many soldiers would be fighting in France. That summer, President Wilson appointed an inquiry of several distinguished experts to gather information on Europe's oppressed peoples, international business, international law, proposals for a peacekeeping organization, and ideas on repairing the war damage in Belgium and France. He said he wanted a basis to decide what would be fair for all, and prophetically warned that seeds of jealousy, discontent, and restrained development could breed future wars. Utilizing this research by experts, Wilson formulated the war aims and peace suggestions of the United States and presented them before Congress on January 8, 1918, as his famous 14 points. He reiterated that the United States was seeking only a peaceful world that is safe for self-governing nations. His specific points may be summarized as follows. 1. Open covenants of peace openly arrived at. No secret treaties. 2. Free navigation of the seas outside territorial waters. 3. Equality of trade and removal of economic barriers. 4. Adequate guarantees given and taken that national armaments will be reduced to the lowest point consistent with domestic safety. 5. Impartial adjustment of all colonial claims weighing equally the interests of the populations with the claims of governments. 6. Evacuation of Russian territory and the opportunity for Russians to choose their own institutions and aid according to their needs and desires. 7. Evacuation and restoration of Belgium under her own sovereignty. 8. Liberation and restoration of invaded French territory and the return of Alsace-Lorraine to France, correcting the wrong of 1871. 9. A readjustment of the frontiers of Italy should be effected along clearly recognizable lines of nationality. 10. The peoples of Austria-Hungary should be freely allowed autonomous development. 11. Romania, Serbia, and Montenegro should be evacuated and restored, and the Balkan states ought to be established along lines of allegiance and nationality with international guarantees of independence and territorial integrity, with access to the sea for Serbia. 12. Turkey itself should have secure sovereignty. but other nationalities should be free of Turkish rule and be assured of autonomous development. And the Dardanelles should be open to all ships and commerce under international guarantees. 13. An independent Poland should include territories of Polish populations, have access to the sea, and guaranteed territorial integrity. 14. A general association of nations must be formed under specific covenants for the purpose of affording mutual guarantees of political independence and territorial integrity to great and small states alike. The president then declared that the United States was willing to fight for these principles to secure liberty and safety for all peoples under international justice. Germany was to be allowed her fair and equal place among the nations, and Wilson requested negotiation with representatives of the majority of the German people rather than the military party and imperialists. These 14 points were adopted by the Allied statesmen as a basis for the peace. Responses to this speech soon came from representatives of Germany and Austria. These replies by Count von Hertling and Count Czernin were answered by Wilson in a speech on February 11th. He was especially critical of the German Chancellor von Hertling. Peace must be established justly in view of world opinion and not involving militarily only the separate states that are most powerful. Wilson also pointed out that there were to be no annexations, no punitive damages, no arbitrary handing of people about by antagonists, but respect for national aspirations and self-determination. Wilson again summarized the great ideals America was fighting for in a 4th of July speech at Mount Vernon. Over 1 million American people had already been shipped to France. The four goals he stated were: 1. Destruction of every arbitrary power that disturbs the world's peace. 2. Settlement of political and economic questions with the consent of those involved, not according to the material interests of other nations. 3. Consent of all nations to live under common law and mutual respect for justice. And 4. Establishment of a peace organization of the free nations' combined power to check violations of peace and justice according to the tribunal of international opinion to which all must submit. By the end of summer 1918, the Central Powers were breaking up, and on September 27th, Wilson appealed to the peoples of those countries by suggesting more specific peace proposals. Once more, he emphasized that right must be made superior to might. The idea of a League of Nations was beginning to take a more definite shape. Each government must be willing to pay the price necessary to achieve impartial justice, to be made effective by the instrumentality of a League of Nations. The constitution of the League of Nations must be a part of the peace settlement. For if it preceded peace, it would be confined to the nations allied against a common enemy. And if it followed the peace settlement, it could not guarantee the peace terms. Wilson then outlined 5 particulars. 1. Impartial justice means no discrimination or favoritism between peoples. 2. No special interest of a single nation should infringe upon the common interest of all. 3. There can be no leagues or alliances or special covenants and understandings within the general and common family of the League of Nations. 4. There can be no selfish economic combinations or boycotts except as may be vested in the League of Nations itself as a means of discipline and control. 5. All international agreements and treaties of every kind must be made known in their entirety to the rest of the world.
Versailles Peace Treaty. President Wilson had come to Europe with a program of peace for all men. His ideal was a very high one, but it involved great difficulties owing to these century-old hatreds between some races. George Clemenceau. On October 6th, the German government requested an armistice. President Wilson sent a reply declaring that the armies of the Central Powers must withdraw immediately from all invaded territory. A German response dodged the issue of evacuation, and therefore another message clarifying the military situation was sent through the Secretary of State. On October 25th, Wilson made perhaps one of his worst political mistakes when he requested the election of a Democratic majority in Congress in order to indicate to the world American support of the president's leadership. This intrusion of party politics into nonpartisan foreign affairs was deeply resented by Republicans and, in fact, backfired against Wilson as the Republicans won both houses. Meanwhile, the Germans agreed to disarm and relinquish the monarchical military leadership and wanted a peace according to the points made in Wilson's speeches. Austria-Hungary also accepted the president's declarations and recognized the rights of the Czechoslovaks and the Yugoslavs. The Allied governments agreed to accept the 14 points and the subsequent addresses, with one reservation by Great Britain on freedom of the seas. Poland and Germany each announced themselves as republics. Finally, on November 11th, German representatives signed the armistice agreement at Marshal Foch's headquarters. The Germans agreed to an almost total surrender and to the payment of reparations. The German Navy was to be dismantled, and its army was to be reduced to 100,000 men. Conscription was abolished, and weapons were strictly limited, allowing no tanks or military aircraft as well as no submarines. However, the German General Staff, which was supposed to be abolished, merely changed its name. If these disarmament conditions had been maintained, the Second World War in Europe could never have occurred as it did. On the same day, President Wilson read the armistice agreement to Congress and promised food and relief to a suffering Europe. He pointed out the disorder in Russia and the folly of attempting conquest by the force of arms. He also asserted, "The nations that have learned the discipline of freedom and that have settled with self-possession to its ordered practice are now about to make conquest of the world by the sheer power of example of friendly helpfulness. America must hold the lamp of liberty for the peoples who were just then coming into their freedom. A peace must be established that will define their places among the nations and protect their security." Wilson decided to attend the peace conference in France with a select group of experts, such as geographers, ethnologists, and economists, whom he told, "Tell me what is right, and I'll fight for it." Unfortunately, he did not invite anyone to attend from the Senate, which later was to cause irreconcilable problems. In Europe, Wilson was enthusiastically greeted by thousands of cheering people, almost as a messiah. After arriving in France in December, he visited England and said that never before in the history of the world had there been such a keen international consciousness. On the same day in Manchester, he spoke of America's desire for peace in the world, not merely a balance of power or peace in Europe. At Rome on January 3, 1919, President Wilson explained how military force is unable to hold people together, that only friendship and goodwill can bind nations together. "Therefore, our task at Paris is to organize the friendship of the world, to see to it that all the moral forces that make for right and justice and liberty are united and are given a vital organization to which the peoples of the world will readily and gladly respond." The idealistic American president, who wanted only permanent peace under universal justice with no special rewards for his country, faced an awesome challenge among the European old-school diplomats, who were determined to gain all they could for their own national interests. Lloyd George had just been re-elected British Prime Minister under the slogan, "Be tough on Germany." and Clemenceau of France was even more adamant about making Germany pay all she could and leaving her as weak as possible. The Italians, represented by Prime Minister Vittorio E. Orlando, and the Japanese wanted control of specific territories, and secret treaties made between the Allies during the war were to emerge and confound several of Wilson's points. Against Wilson's protests, the conference news was censored, and what did leak out to the press tended to be through the French newspapers controlled by their government. Meanwhile, most of Europe was in turmoil, and many military leaders wanted to grab what they could get. For this reason, on January 24th, Wilson published a statement warning those who would take possession of territory by force that they would be prejudicing their cause, because they were placing in doubt the justice of their claims, which the peace conference must determine. The next day, he addressed the peace conference, which he felt had two purposes: not only the settlements required by the war, but also the secure establishment of a means for the maintaining of world peace. Wilson believed the League of Nations was necessary for both purposes. He argued that settlements may be temporary, but their actions as nations for peace and justice must be permanent. Although they could not make permanent decisions, they could set up permanent processes. Therefore, the League of Nations must be made vital and continuous so that it may be ever watchful and effective. The idea for a league as an essential part of the treaty was adopted unanimously by the representatives of the 32 states present on January 25th, and a subcommittee for the drafting of a League of Nations covenant was selected with President Wilson as chairman. On January 27th, Wilson suggested a solution to the problem of what to do about the German colonies. Because he felt world opinion was against annexations, the League of Nations could mandate that districts be administered by a mandatory power for the improvement of the inhabitants' conditions, and without discriminatory economic access. General Jan Christian Smuts, the leader from South Africa who had confronted Gandhi, had published a pamphlet, The League of Nations, A Practical Suggestion, calling for a strong and active league which could not only prevent wars but also be a living and working organ of peaceful civilization. It must have a general control of international affairs involving commerce, communications, and social, industrial, and labor relations. Smuts proposed the mandate system by which powerful nations would be assigned to oversee temporarily the former colonies of Germany and the non-Turkish portions of the former Ottoman Empire that needed assistance. Wilson and Colonel House, the American members of the committee, managed to get together with the British delegates, Smuts and Lord Cecil, who also had his own draft, to hammer out what was called Wilson's second draft, which was revised into an Anglo-American version. Although the French and Italians submitted drafts, this version was accepted as the basis for discussion. Working every night, the committee of 14 members turned out its draft agreement after 11 days. Wilson announced that a living thing had been born. A proud President Wilson presented the League of Nations draft to the Peace Conference with an address on February 14th. The League was to consist of a body of delegates, an executive council, and a permanent secretariat. Any issue of international relationship would have free discussion because that is the moral force of public opinion. Nevertheless, if moral force did not suffice, armed force was to be in the background, but only as a last resort. The League was designed to be simple and flexible, yet a definite guarantee of peace, at least in words. Securing peace was not the only purpose of the League. It could be used for cooperation in any international matter, such as ameliorating labor conditions. All international agreements must be registered with the Secretary General and openly published. Wilson believed the mandate policy of aiding development was a great advance over annexation and exploitation.
All in all, Wilson felt that they had created a document that was both practical and humane, that could serve the conscience of the world. The day after the draft was accepted by the plenary session, the president departed for the United States. In Washington, Wilson met with congressional representatives to discuss the League. By the time he returned to France in March 1919, American public opinion was insisting on four alterations. First, the Monroe Doctrine must be explicitly protected. Second, there must be a way nations could withdraw from the League. Third, domestic disputes must be exempt from League interference, including tariffs and immigration quotas. Fourth, a nation must have the right to refuse a mandate for a territory. Wilson felt that these provisions were not necessary, but he was willing to get them put into the covenant for the sake of its acceptance. However, he had to compromise in order to do so, and thus his position on other issues was weakened. Colonel House had been compromising on every side at the peace talks, such that when Wilson returned to Paris, he felt he had to start all over again. This caused an irreparable breach between the president and his close friend and advisor. The Allies were forcing unbearable reparations and indemnities on Germany and the defeated nations. Wilson did not consider it wise for England to retain naval supremacy, or for the American and British navies to patrol the world together. Militarism on the sea is the same as on the land. He felt that power must not be vested in a single nation or combination of nations. The sea is a free highway and should be protected by a league of all the nations under international law. Wilson developed a comprehensive plan for disarmament to fulfill one of his most important points. Armaments were only to be used to preserve domestic safety and to maintain international order according to the League. Compulsory military service and the private manufacture of munitions must be abolished. Disarmament policies must be worked out after the peace settlement, be unanimously agreed upon, and have publicity to assure compliance. Although disarmament was temporarily forced upon Germany, these policies were never universally carried out. Wilson persistently argued for a new attitude of mind and an organization of cooperation for peace which considered moral force above armed force. Returning to the negotiations of the peace settlement, Wilson faced intransigent obstacles to his principles. Several territorial arrangements had already been agreed upon by the major powers during the war in such secret agreements as the Sykes-Picot Treaty and the Treaty of London. Wilson spoke up for self-determination, and at his suggestion, a commission of inquiry was sent to the Middle East to discover what the people's wishes were. The other powers verbally agreed, but never did send their representatives. By the time the Americans went and returned with their information, the issues had been settled. The French wanted not only Alsace-Lorraine, but also the coal mining district of Saar and a buffer state in the Rhineland. Italy wanted not only the opposite coast of the Adriatic, including Trieste, which had been promised in the Treaty of London, but they also demanded the port of Fiume, which represented Yugoslavia's only hope for a commercial port. England and Japan had divided up the German colonies in the Pacific Ocean, giving Japan those north of the equator and Britain those south of the equator. But Japan also wanted Shandong on the mainland. In early April 1919, Wilson became ill. He had reached the limit of his patience and requested that the ocean liner George Washington be prepared to take him home. The president decided to take a stand on the issue of Fiume. It had not been included in the Pact of London because it naturally belonged to the Yugoslav state. Wilson consequently went to the public with his arguments, and the Italian delegation withdrew from the conference. With the Italians already turning their back on the League, the Japanese saw their chance to push for control of the Shandong province in China. Wilson backed China's rights and lectured the nations on their duties toward each other. However, he did not want Japan to leave also and perhaps form an alliance with Russia and Germany. Neither England nor America was willing to go to war with Japan over Shandong. Therefore, it was agreed that Japan would control Shandong temporarily, and Wilson hoped that the League of Nations would later rectify the situation for China. Above all, Wilson struggled to save the League itself. The Italians never did get Fiume, but they did return to sign the final treaty. By preventing an unjust decision, a war between the Yugoslavs and the Italians was made less likely. Wilson also compromised with the French on the Saar and Rhineland districts, and annexations were modified into temporary mandate agreements. Germany had been suffering greatly. A food blockade by the Allies had been maintained against them for 4 months after the armistice. Finally, at the instigation of Herbert Hoover, President Wilson convinced the Allied leaders that the blockade must be lifted for humanitarian reasons. The treaty agreed upon by the Allies and neutral nations was presented to the Germans on May 7th. Their response on May 29th repeatedly complained of failures of the treaty to adhere to the 14 points and subsequent addresses. They felt unnecessarily humiliated by the severe provisions the French had demanded. However, facing the threat of Marshal Foch moving the French army in on them, the Germans decided to sign a treaty. On June 28, 1919, the Treaty of Versailles was signed by Clemenceau, Lloyd George, Wilson, and other representatives of the nations. When Austria signed the peace treaty in September 1919, the major powers and several other nations signed the Convention for the Control of the Trade in Arms and Ammunition, which prohibited arms sales in most of Africa and part of Asia. The Central American states adopted a convention on arms limitation on February 7, 1923. United States rejection of the League. Wilson was greeted by 10,000 people when he returned to New York. However, in the Senate, there were strong isolationist sentiments against the treaty. Presenting it to the Senate on July 10th, President Wilson wondered forebodingly, "Dare we reject it and break the heart of the world?" A few irreconcilables were completely against the League. Many senators favored it, but ratification of a treaty required 2/3 of the Senate. A third group, led by Senator Lodge, demanded reservations, particularly to Article 10 of the League Covenant, which read, "The members of the League undertake to respect and preserve, as against external aggression, the territorial integrity and existing political independence of all members of the League. In case of any such aggression, or in case of any threat or danger of such aggression, the Council shall advise upon the means by which this obligation shall be fulfilled." For Wilson, this was the key article. It was the Monroe Doctrine applied to the world and protected by all. The president explained to the senators that this was a moral obligation, but not necessarily a legal obligation. Senator Warren Harding asked what good it would do if it was only a moral obligation, which a nation could ignore since it was not legally bound. Wilson pointed out that because it was not legally binding, the nation would have the right to exercise its moral judgment in each case. Lloyd George had explained that the covenant did not necessarily imply military action in support of the imperiled nation, but mainly economic pressure and sanctions against the aggressing nation. Former President Taft favored ratifying the League Covenant and agreed that the chance of getting involved in a war was small because of the universal boycott, which in most cases would be effective. Only a world conspiracy would require the members of the League to unite against it, and in that case, the sooner the better. Taft, a Republican, believed the United States could not be forced into a war against its will, and to think so was a narrow and reactionary viewpoint. Nevertheless, opposition in the Senate was growing. Therefore, President Wilson decided to take his case to the people with a busy speaking tour across the whole country. Young Americans had fought and died in France, and he would not give up the struggle for a world of peace without giving all he could. Wilson argued that the League of Nations was founded according to the American principle of self-government, open discussion, and arbitration instead of war, a universal boycott of an offending nation, disarmament, rehabilitation of oppressed peoples, no annexations but trusteeships, abolition of forced labor, especially of women and children, rejection of secret treaties, protection of dependent peoples, high standards of labor, the Red Cross, international regulation of drugs and alcohol, and prohibition of arms sales. He warned against violent revolutions such as had occurred in Russia rather than revolution by vote. The United States could be isolated no more, for it has become a determining factor in human history and in the development of civilization. He declared that peace of the world could not be established without America. 7.5 million men had been killed in the war. This was more than all the wars from 1793 to 1914. He spoke of the children who would have to die in a worse war if the League of Nations was not established. Wilson pushed himself to the limit, traveling 8,000 miles in 22 days and giving 38 speeches. He had increasingly bad headaches, which became constant until he finally collapsed in Pueblo, Colorado. The train took him straight back to Washington, where he suffered a stroke that left the left side of his face and body paralyzed. His wife, Edith, coordinated his presidential responsibilities. The push in the Senate for reservations to the treaty was strong, but Wilson refused to give in because it would be repudiating what each nation had signed. If the United States demanded changes, then why could not the Germans also? Thus, the president asked those who supported the treaty to vote against ratification with the reservations, and consequently, the treaty was never ratified by the United States. Wilson hoped, perhaps, to be nominated again for president in 1920, but he was a broken man. The Republican Harding declared nebulously that he favored some sort of association of nations, and he was elected for a return to normalcy. In Wilson's last public statement on Armistice Day, November 11, 1923, he lamented, "I have seen fools resist Providence before, and I have seen their destruction." He still believed that his principles would eventually prevail. He died on February 3, 1924.